Do we do anything but talk about butts? That's how I always think the show is.
Yeah, I mean, butts are great. They're in and out. You know, they're a fun time.
Hold on. I mean, when you say in and out, I mean, stuff goes in and out of them, but.
Sure.
All right, let's start the show. Nailed it.
Okay.
Hello, you beautiful citizens of the internet. It's Night Attack, bringing you the best of the worst of the internet ever since 1776. My name is Brian Brushwood, live in Austin, Texas. Joined, as always, by my BFF and OAK, it's JRY, Justin Robert Young. How are you, sir?
Oh, man. Great to be here. Great to be back. You want to know what? We're just living the dream over here in Oakland, California.
I'm feeling the pressure, man. I'm feeling it.
Why?
Heavy.
Why, Brian? Why are you feeling the pressure?
Well, because Ice Cream Social, our friends Paul Mattingly and Matt Donnelly, I did the thing, and a bunch of people were really excited, and then they went and they listened to Night Attack, and now we have like new fans that we have to audition for. We have to be good.
I know. They're adding on to the 12 people that listen to the show.
I know. Brian, it's the 13th. It's the Judas Apostle has finally showed up.
Oh, yeah.
In all seriousness, that was a total blast. If it just dropped yesterday, as a matter of fact, take a listen to that. I think it's pretty funny. They're funny guys. They're funny guys. Would it be talking out of school to tell you the Chris Ketter story? I feel like it would be.
Yeah. I don't know. I think it's it's your relationship.
Body
that's on the line.
Off screen, Body is holding a wine in one hand and exaggeratedly doing the ixnay on the Opperfield gay talk. but I think David Copperfield listened to it and thought it was a pretty good interview. Is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Yeah. But, dude, man, I'm excited. I'm excited to get out and get spread the good news. It feels good to make it a job to show up on other people's podcasts.
Plug the Modern Rogue.
Well, I mean, just to plug all of our stuff, right? Like, I realized, like, that was a entire arm of promotion that I was just refusing to take part of. I just felt like, oh, I don't know, that just seems like I'll be doing you a lot of work, and I don't want to do charity for free, because I'm so overwhelmed. My job is, I'm overwhelmed, man. My superpower is to be constantly overwhelmed. And it's good to kind of reject that and get back to a place where I'm like, yeah, man, I'll do your thing. Let's party. You guys should check out our stuff.
So have you had a good good time so far?
Yeah, I've done like four podcast appearances.
What else is in the can
in the last week?
And did you describe Night Attack as not funny in all of them, or just Ice Cream Social?
Wait, did I say that?
Maybe a little bit.
Oh no, that's me trying to be self-deprecating. You know, I mean, that's like me cowering at the.
I'm sure everybody who's meeting you for the first time picked up on that too.
God damn it. I feel bad now. Okay. Oh, doggone it. Now you're going to put me on the spot and I don't even know the name of half the stuff. Here we go. Here's one, John Lane's podcast I did, look on Twitter. And then, that's Johnny Boy Lane. And then also, the Standard podcast, I think it's called,
The Statement Show?
The Statement Show. That's what it is. Did I say The Standard? Yeah. I meant The Statement. Tomorrow night, I'm going to be doing The Skeptic's Guide to the Universe. And in fact, let's make this a group thing. Everybody who has a podcast that you think I would be a fit for, just tell me and I'll reach out to them. That'd be great.
Absolutely. No, totally.
Yeah. So what about you? How are you doing?
Well, I guess the show is not supposed to be funny, so that probably makes a lot of sense.
What did I say that made you twinge? I feel bad.
Oh no! I mean, it's like they were plugging Night Attack, and you cut them off by saying like, "Oh, that's just a show where we're trying to be funny," and then they were like, "No, but it's well regarded," and you're like, "I mean, like 12 people listened to it."
Oh God damn it! Well, okay, they
are
bigger.
Very aggressively self-deprecating. And, like, I know you, and I know that you're not trying to, like, bury the show or anything, right?
Yes.
You know, it was just you, like, you know, doing a little bit too hard of the this old thing.
Yes.
Like, you know.
Yeah, by the way, the chat is just burying me right now.
you know what? I think we need just to workshop this, because there is a certain buy-in. Like, the humor is not for everybody. So there's, like...
Well, and that's the thing, like, is I don't want to oversell it as because right. I don't know.
Because
like,
it's
like,
kind of a family, and it's kind of... And it's also funny. But
it's almost hostile to outsiders, right?
Right. I mean, not entirely.
Okay,
I think
these are things that we know. They are not necessarily, like... The thing that you have to say, like, everybody knows that when you eat at Taco Bell, you might have to shit something fierce in like 30 minutes. But they lead with, "We sell tacos and burritos." They don't say out front, "We're gonna make you shit in 30 minutes."
Well, I guess
Brian just talks about tacos and burritos. I don't know.
Yeah, right? My dick is a burrito. Your pussy is a taco. Let me put my burrito in your taco.
It's just one of those things that, like, you know. Like, maybe let them say, "Hey, it's a funny show. I've listened to it. It's good. You have a very passionate fan base." Because then later in the show, you go and talk about the Diamond Club.
Yes. Which, yes.
Like, is you know, a big group thing, right? But it doesn't really mean as much if you don't set up, "Oh, we have this show that people like, that people listen to."
Okay, fair enough. In future interviews, I pinky promise that I will endeavor to represent more accurately.
This is your job, so I'm going to trust you to do it. It's not like I'm on these shows, so I wouldn't want you noting me. That's fine.
You just don't need to make Night Attack the redheaded stepchild.
I don't know. There's part of me that deeply loves that reputation for Night Attack, though. I think that's part of, like, this is the night, like, I don't know. I think part of me loves to pretend... Like, Night Attack, I know when we're all here, we're all naked and having a party, but it's so freaky that I kind of want to act like, "Oh, you're crazy enough to want to come to this party. We get all naked and freaky on the internet."
That sounds suspiciously like, if it were popular, it would be not cool anymore.
Well, exactly. Like no, I'm almost...
kind of sounds suspiciously like... No, the rest of my D&D group. If I told my popular friends about you, then everything would be ruined.
Yeah, okay. All right. No. Fair enough. Fair enough. That's good. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, all right. I will endeavor to more accurately represent the quality of the show. Also, I totally volunteered us to be at their Scoops Fest in late September. I hope that's fine. Can you do that?
I hope all 12 of you can.
God damn it. I was speaking in relative terms. They've got bigger numbers. We're a cult.
It was a metaphor.
What about you, man? How's your week been?
Pretty good. Back finally from the road. We're in the crunch time on the crunch time on Action News. So I'm working on that, and we got a cool contender sale coming up tomorrow, but. It's been a lot of nose to the grindstone kind of stuff. You know, I came back physically and emotionally changed from WrestleMania 33. It really changed my outlook on life.
No, and, okay. Now I know you're offering a bombastic line here, but I kind of believe there's a nugget of truth to what you're saying. Like how did it affect you?
No, there's no qualifier. It is the absolute truth. I am not kidding. This is not hyperbole. I was deeply moved by the spectacle of not only WrestleMania 33, but also the whole weekend around. I don't know. It's just kind of amazing. It's sort of like it's a very weird, off-putting hobby to many people. And yet from all over the world, the person to my left literally spent, the money that we spent on our tickets, which were good, flew down by himself from Glasgow, Scotland, so we could watch WrestleMania by himself.
Wow.
Right? Dude on the other side, same thing, but from Canada. And it was just like, wow, you know, like this is, if you put effort and you put, you know, time and work, and you have an audience of anywhere between 11 and 13 people, you know, there's no limit to what you can do. Like, you know, you can just blow it up.
He's mocking me. Go ahead.
So I'm just saying that, you know, it was something that really kind of motivated me to just sort of think about you know, what I have and where my effort you know, should be, and to just like have faith that things can get bigger and grow.
You know what? I never paused to think about the similarity between the way we do stuff on Night Attack and professional wrestling, because it is outrageous, it is over the top, it is at times hilarious and everything, but there is authenticity in it that is unparalleled. You know, I think about Max Landis's Wrestling Isn't Wrestling video, where it's like no other narrative form blends in this curious mix of pure fakeness that bleeds into reality and pure reality that bleeds into the fakeness. And you could make a case that there's a fair amount of that on Night Attack, because yes, we try to be funny at times, but also we're very confessional, right?
Oh, certainly. And it just kind of like why do people want to watch us? Right. There was this thing. Did you hear? I'm not going to get in my Norm MacDonald, Jay Leno thing, but like,
oh, no, come on, do it. Give it. Give me the full Norm.
Just
pretend we're doing a live event.
I'm listening back.
A bachelorette party shows up at our live event. You're holding a mic in your hand, and take it away.
Have you heard this? this lady on YouTube. She's gonna make a sex tape once she gets to a million subscribers.
Yeah,
no, that's it. I really, I literally just wanted to tell you about that.
It's pretty good. It's a. I'll tell you what. That's a good. That's a good promotional gimmick.
Have you seen this?
No, right. No. Who is this? Wait, lady, why is it gross?
Find this lady that somebody has.
Just go to the Googles, type in lady, and I'm sure she'll be right there.
YouTube sex tape, 1 million subscribers.
YouTuber promises sex tape for 1 million subscribers.
I think the actual video is like three links down. On that.
This is like literally whoring, though.
Well so, hold on. It's
in for viewership.
Well,
sort of.
Okay. Wait,
sort of. Subscribers. Doesn't mean they're actually it's
not Bonnie.
What? I'm going to.
It's not literally whoring.
It is. I'm going to whore shame here.
Go whore shame?
Wow.
Sex workers? Wow.
Man, I'll tell you what. It might be in the same era, but we went from Norm MacDonald to church lady real quick. A million subscribers for a sex tape.
I wonder who would be interested in that deal.
YouTube.com/whore.
I was trying to cue you up for a Satan bit.
So here we go. Lena the plug.
Sex tape at 1 mil.
I
mean, look.
But hi, I am.
This is pretty close to a sex tape already.
You may not have heard that. I'm planning on making a sex tape.
I've got three girls. I don't want this.
Okay, here. Pause this, Bryce. Pause this.
What?
Here's what I want to do, Brian.
Yes.
You and I, we're gonna clear the floor. I just want Bonnie to just narrate, just comment on what she's saying, and Bonnie. Leave no whore shaming threat left held back. I want your honest opinion.
This is gonna go very badly for me, I think.
Let's go.
Okay, you're about to find out how bad I am.
All right.
And no problems with it, but just no interest in doing it. But
I have very low self esteem.
Oh, and Bonnie. Oh God, Bonnie, what are you doing? Oh, you're killing me.
Yeah.
This is very much on the line. This is beyond the line of slut shaming. This is just.
No, it's like. It's
opposite
totally,
of sex positivity.
I think that women have a lot more to offer. It's like, okay, here's a totally different take.
Oh, so you, okay, if I may, it sounds to me like you are less concerned with, yes, this will positively affect her, but it has ripples that make it more difficult for our daughters to succeed in science and technology and STEM stuff, right?
Oh, I mean, we've suffered for a very
long time. I don't know. I feel like you tapped a radioactive vein of plutonium, Justin. I don't know what's going on here.
Well, I'll tell you in a parallel thing, though. Like, early on in Brian's career, he, like, did a lot of sideshow stuff because he just didn't have, like, the confidence just...
Okay, I'm less concerned about the slut shaming. I'm more concerned with the Brian shaming happening right now.
I'm not shaming. I mean, on the one, but it was like
Brian had to have at least 8 fans.
Yeah, I mean, plus also, my pants were all the way above my belly button. I'll have you remember during this time.
But, like, you know, you didn't need to staple money to your forehead for, like, you know, sensational things.
I did, though. I
mean, did you?
Okay,
we have a no permanent damage rule, right?
Yes. Okay.
Okay, I feel like this steps into no permanent damage permanent damage.
What is damaged?
You don't get to take that back. It's out on the internet. You're a grandma, you got a sex tape.
Wait a minute. Are you talking about stapling money to his head or him having sex on camera for 1 million subscribers?
Keep in mind, for context, Bonnie is the mother of 3 beautiful daughters, one of which is entering teenagedom, and I would imagine that affects the areas that you are sensitive about, right?
Completely.
Sorry. Wow. If you guys could see the withering laser-eyed look that I just got from Bonnie. Oh, my God. I just bored a hole through the back of my head.
Now, Bonnie, what if I told you that your opinion on this is literally the gas that makes this exciting for people?
Right.
The fact that there are people that are like, oh, no. No, that's wrong. That's what makes all of this exciting.
I don't think so. I think her boobs made it exciting for her subscribers. I think that is pretty simple.
Well, but that's just it, is that it rides the line. The last time I saw a controversy like this was when a girl went to Craigslist and said, I want an epic mount, which is a very rare thing in World of Warcraft, and I am willing to have sex with anyone who will give me one. Since per the terms of agreement, gold has no value, property on World of Warcraft has no value, there's no way you can legally call this prostitution, but I will have sex with you, BT dubs, I like cosplay. And then everybody went nuts calling her names, you know, a slut, a whore, and all that stuff. And then later she was just like, I got my epic mount, including a screenshot of her avatar on a griffin or whatever. And everybody got real mad and indignant. And I don't know, I suppose it's because at any given time, everybody wants sex to mean something different for themselves and also for other people, right? Is that what it is, Justin?
I think so. I think that there's just that between that and... the idea that I think part of what Bonnie, and you can stop me if I'm wrong, that she's reacting to is that as a woman, you know that there is permanent damage associated with reputational stuff, you know, that like gossip and reputation kind of can dictate in a very real way where you get to in life. And so the idea that we would be applauding her effectively doing a death-defying stunt for the rest of her future should be something that we should take a step back and say, no, I don't know, maybe not. Think about, you know, what's going to happen when you're 80, when literally everybody else is just like, sub it up, that girl's got a donk.
Sure. I think that's an interesting term, like a death-defying feat for your future. I mean, I certainly, like, Brian did some stunts early on, but we always passed it under... how risky is this?
Yeah.
And I feel like she's crossed the line on the risky.
Well, okay. Well, but understand there's a whole sea of women, that are already past that line who do, pornography. Like, do you feel like they're all whores or whatever?
Oh,
you said?
I'm sorry. I was taking her as a legitimate. I mean, like, if that's sort of the field she wants to go into,
I mean,
then,
that's the thing. Is
I guess so.
Basically the only.
I mean,
thing
I hadn't
changed.
Really considered that maybe she wants to be in pornography as a field.
Like, that's
like if
I...
that's if that's where she wants to end up with her life, then go for it, you know. But like,
So I watched the video. She says she's been an Instagram model for a while. In the time that she's been an Instagram model, she's been approached to do porn many times. She's always turned it down because porn doesn't interest her. But the idea of having sex with her boyfriend and releasing that as a sex tape is something that she has more of an excitement for, especially. And by the way, she posts that video. Bryce, check out what her sub count is now. It was up at the 700s.
778,000.
So 778,000 in this video, which was posted January 17th, she says she had 37,000.
Wow. So really, the only thing that's
different... By the way, that sound is what emits from Brian when he looks at his trajectory curve on Modern Rogue.
What, you see what I'm saying?
That's a lot more than 12 subscribers, I mean, for the record.
Also,
all we're going to do is promise, Brian.
But also,
we don't have to deliver. We can just say, psych, April Fools.
All we got to do is promise one time.
Oh, I'm sorry. April 7th was opposite day. I forgot to mention that when I made that promise.
But then when women hit 30s, then they have to play the evil witch instead of the hot, you know, like, I mean, in movies, like, if you're 30, you're so old that you have to play the crone character.
Yeah, you know? That's when you go from teen to MILF.
Yeah, well,
yeah, it is age 30. Yeah,
yeah, and yeah. I don't know. I mean, what kind of life? I don't know. I just feel like it's.
I feel a lot of I feel a lot of concern from you, Bonnie, for her, because your perspective is this is something you can't take back, and this is not something I would personally do.
Right.
But I think, like, this is just with the vast sea of pornography that is out there, and not to mention
you're saying that we're on a trajectory for the stigma to be completely erased from having a sex tape out in the wild.
This would almost certainly be a part of it, right? Because this feels exciting for people because it breaks a norm. There are Instagram girls, there are YouTube girls, there are cam girls, right? But like, popular YouTube celebrity sex tape is not something that has broken loose on any kind of national level as internet culture kind of gets bigger and bigger. She's saying, I'll be the first, and all you have to do is make me a YouTube celebrity by getting me to 1 million subs. And then, boom.
Yeah,
I will fill that cultural need, but it'll never be the same after that.
And what's funny is I guess the norm is with pornography, we see after the fact, after they've made this life decision and you see the other side, the only difference is that you're just seeing the before photo. And she's saying, I intend to make this transition.
She's kickstarting.
Yeah. She's accepting the subscriptions up front so that she can. Later, because think about it, Kim Kardashian, the sex tape got leaked, and that's why she became super famous. Paris Hilton, same thing. So she's just doing the reverse order. Like, get me famous first, and then I'll release the sex tape. And then you'll be happy, and
Because both of them were ex-famous, and then they became Y-famous. Like, Paris Hilton had the very popular TV show, then she became Y-famous.
Oh, pornstarter.com. That should be a thing. Pornstarter.com.
Okay, whoever posted that needs to, register that title right now.
Pornstarter, if I get 100,000 chubs, then let's go. And everybody subscribes.
I don't know. I guess in my career.
Clitstarter.
Clitstarter. Oh, that's funny.
For the ladies.
I love that. Okay. No, I found that, it was really frustrating when I was beginning in my art career because I had several men approach me just expecting me to sleep with them to sell art. They're buying art was also me just spreading my legs. I finally just got out and just stayed at home.
So that has to make it a very personal thing.
Really frustrating. Because that's not a line I wanted to go down. It's not something, I was happily married.
Cockstarter.
Oh, you guys are coming up with some good titles there. I love
that Bonnie's pouring her heart out in Brian.
Well, he's got a hell of a view over here with all these.
Coming in on the chat.
Well, and I would imagine that for you, the part that is most upsetting is the idea of compromise. Like, if you knew...
Or just the expected compromise. Just like, I was just like, oh, I'm sorry. I mean, one person, I was like, oh, I'm sorry. It became really, like, aggressive. I was like, I'm married. No, thank you.
Penis, and he just go-go. Goes, I'm sorry.
And he just goes like, oh, that's okay. And I was just like, fuck you. And I'm just like...
So to you, the offensive part is not the act of taping yourself having sex, not the act of releasing it out in the wild. For you, the offensive part is compromising, is the engine of compromise that chews up so many artists who, because in your mind, this is somebody who wants to speak her mind and be heard, and you see the disgust comes from, well, the price of admission is if you want a million people to listen, you better show somebody pounding you from behind.
Right.
Go fuck me.
Oh, that's a good one.
That's a good one. Now, the thing I hadn't considered is that maybe she's just totally fine with it.
This is the best conversation we've ever had in the history of Night Attack. Congratulations, Scoops. You guys came on a good night.
Credit to MBeam there. Bonnie, I mean, I think a part of it is that culture, right? It's like, oh, it's art and you work in art and everyone's in art and we all smoke cigarettes and finger each other's urethras.
What does one of those parties look like?
Yeah, keep telling me about that.
What kind of music?
This is how do you say in the American urethra fingering? In Ibiza, we finger each other's urethras.
In my mind, you're Jermaine Clement from Legion, dressed in exactly that outfit, holding a martini while you talk about it.
All right, so. This is a weird start to a show.
No, but I don't know. I feel like this is the best of Night Attack, where we've explored.
It's the best of Night Attack. I'll tell you what, it's actually only going to get better. Not only do we have an amazing game, we also are joined by Will Harris. Sorry, Brian. Was there something else you wanted to say?
Yes, I want to encourage everybody to go to Matreon. Matreon.com/Night Attack.
And if you've got a very, very, very tantalizing pairing, you can always submit it to the Jerk Tank. We've got Will Harris, the original Britto, is going to join us right after this, as well as a game that will reach the youth of America. But before we do that, let's go ahead and give a big shout out to all 12 of you who are possible. Night Attack's Patreon. Patreon.com/Night Attack is where you can kick in a little bit of scratch to keep this party going. Thank you to everybody who continues to make this the best part of my week.
Absolutely, man. And in fact, we like to give a little shout out to our friends, because we don't know what you're doing right now. You could be watching YouTube videos while you listen to us. You could be exploring pornography. You could be on a treadmill. But whoever you are, if you're somebody who just raised your pledge or jumped in at the $1 episode mark, then you might be able to participate in...
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Night Attack new Patreon name chant corner hour.
It's an hour of it. I don't know what he's doing. Justin, what do you think this guy's doing?
Oh, man, I think this guy is... I think he's doing promo for his YouTube show, and he's like on a podcast, but he's listening to a podcast, and he's just said something that he doesn't know his co-host is going to drag him for in another week and a half. I think that's...
Okay, so while you're in the middle of your podcast, I hope you're having a great time with our new friends over at Ice Cream Social. Kyle Phillips. Kyle Phillips.
Phillips.
Wait, who just said that?
That's my new impression, my new Ashley impression. You want to hear it?
Yeah, do it again.
All right, here we go.
Kyle Phillips.
It sounds an awful lot like Ashley.
It is, right? It's a pretty good one. I've been working on it. It's that and Rush Limbaugh.
All right, hey, thank you so much, Kyle Phillips. We hope that you enjoy being on a podcast downplaying your involvement in the success of Night Attack. Hey, man. Dude, our guest is on the line.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, direct from foggy old London town, he is the original Britto. Let's put your hands together for Wil Harris.
Woo! USA, USA. It's probably inappropriate to cheer your.
It's 3 a.m. here. I wasn't asleep. I was thinking about going to sleep. It's 3 a.m., but I wasn't sleeping.
I'm glad.
Can I get you some peanut butter? I'm English peanut butter with some jam. I'm Alfred, I'm Oatfee's English.
Alfred!
Never. I'm English, never. But we weren't sleeping, certainly not sleeping together. Can I get you anything?
I've always wondered where Oatfee goes once he goes to bed. He goes to bed in England.
Oh, Alfred, thank you so much for coming. I was not asleep. I was not going to sleep. Maybe in a second, but not now. I'm so glad you've made the trip from across the pond, Alfred.
I mean, a 3 a.m. booty call is ambitious, but you know.
All right, so longtime friend of the show, Wil Harris, is here, and all I know is that Bryce had cooked up something. Can you spill the beans on what you cooked?
Sure. Well, I figured we got Brian, who's blowing up on YouTube, right?
Sure.
You got Justin, who is
killing it on Twitch.
Yeah, I've got six fans.
That's right. When we get divorced, each of us takes six fans apiece.
So make your choice. Don't have to tell anybody, but write it down.
I figured, you know, with the age of social media, I wanted to find out who best.
Wait, what do I have, Bryce? Sorry. Like, Brian's blowing up on YouTube, Justin's blowing up on Twitch, and also Wil Harris.
Yeah, and Peggy.
Jeez. Thanks, guys.
I mean, listen, Bryce, Wil's going through some stuff, man. He's going through a transformational period in his life. You got to give him at least a little something to you know, get him going here.
That's
transforming
right.
These biceps, bro.
Guns out, guns out. Yeah.
I do love your new full-time profession of posting gym selfies. Although Will's new thing is not posting gym selfies. He just posts not the gym selfies that everybody else does, where they're like ripped after like working out and they get like a big, like, you know, like, oh, hashtag gains, bro. It's always just Will exhausted, just like laying down. I'm so tired, but thankfully I have great trainers. It's adorable. It's amazing.
So that.
Yeah, it's a hard life, man. It's a hard life. So sorry, Bryce. I interrupted you.
No. So Will has a burgeoning Instagram empire formed around his biceps. Justin has Twitch.
Oh, my
Twitch.
God. Guys, if I get a million Instagram followers, I will record a sex tape.
It'll be me by myself logged into Pornhub. It'll be great.
Exactly. Although, to be fair, in the UK, the colloquial term for a sex tape is politely signing a contract with somebody. So it's a totally different thing. They have a different standard for sex tape.
So I wanted to see how well you guys understood what it is that teens, millennials, the new Gen Z.
Oh, dude, no. Oh, dude, we're plugged in. We are you kidding me? There's nobody that knows teenagers better than dudes approaching and possibly past 40 years old. I think we're ready to go.
That's right. So Google, you might have heard about this last week. Google
site called Google.
Google.com did a report, did a survey of millennials which they classified as 18 to 24-year-olds, and Gen Z.
By the way, that's not millennials. Justin's a millennial. We already had this discussion.
I swear to God, stop it.
You're a millennial. Look, you're sporting an ironic hipster mustache, and you dress up like ironic. Ron Burgundy.
It's not ironic. It's to let everybody know that the Action News Kickstarter launches June 29th.
Okay, that's the literal definition of sporting an ironic mustache is when you're not doing it because you think—
It's an informative mustache. It's not ironic.
No, it's totally— Okay, all right. Typical millennials, am Typical, I right?
Right?
These millennials.
They're participation Kickstarters.
Refusing to admit their detached irony. No, we really believe we could save the world. We're millennials.
The only irony that needs detaching is that mustache from Justin's face.
No.
Hey.
Boom.
Knock it off.
All right.
So Google published a report called It's Lit, A Guide to What's Cool for Teenagers.
Oh, dude, we're so plugged in on this. We got this.
And it asked teenagers what their favorite brands were.
Yeah.
And it made these really large plot graphs of what brands the teens thought were cool. So I came up with this game, What Brands Touch Teens? And so we're going to find out if you guys really
know.
Oh,
audio listeners, I'm so sorry that you're missing the beautiful visual of the clip art.
You're definitely going to have to subscribe to youtube.com/nightattack.
Oh, this is great. All right.
So we're going to find out. We're going to go around the horn. We got three different rounds. We're going to find out with the easy round what you think millennials prefer. I'll give you an A and a B, and you're going to tell me which one you think is more popular. Then round two, we'll do it for Generation Z. 13 to 17 year olds.
Oh, geez. Wait, my daughter is a— they have a name for my daughter? She's Generation Z?
Gen Z.
No, not to get attached to it, because 20 years later, some asshole in a magazine is going to tell her that she's another name.
Yeah, no, that's a thing. Sorry, millennials. That's their existential crisis. We had 9/11. They had the changing of their generation's name.
I had 9/11. I did have 9/11.
All right. Let's not fight. There's plenty of 9/11 for everyone.
All right. So we'll just go down the list here. We'll start with Brian.
Yeah.
Between Tesla and Burt's Bees, what did millennials think was cooler?
Tesla by a million percent.
Tesla or Burt's Bees?
Or Burt's Bees.
Yeah, Burt's Bees.
No, what Burt's Bees was a bees? Thing for my generation.
Well, and Burt's Bees is a brand that you physically touch, whereas Tesla is an aspirational thing that most people don't have but want. So I'm figuring Tesla for the win.
Okay.
I don't know, though, but also, like, you know, sure, there were those kids in middle school that, like, you know, had car posters on their wall, but there were a lot more people that just like Now and Later's had a hotter reputation when I was in school than like a Ferrari.
Yeah, but Now and Later's did not save the planet the way Tesla's do. Burt's Bees exploits bees. Millennials hate exploitation. They want those bees to be free.
All right, I'm gonna say all right. I'll say Tesla.
All right, Will, what do you think?
I feel like this game would work better if it had brands that existed in England.
Oh, no! You don't have Burt's
like
Bees?
Burt's Bees? Is it like alphabet spaghetti or something?
Burt's
lip balm. It's honey-based lip balm.
Honey-based lip balm.
Oh, of course it is.
Yeah.
You know, the stinging insect that dies upon injecting poison into you?
Sure.
That's the brand of a honey flavored
lip balm. Is it similar to the stinging pain of rejection that I'm feeling right now? You know what? I'm going to game theory it. Burt's Bees.
You're going to say Burt's Bees. All right. Millennials actually found that Tesla was the cooler brand.
Boom. Nice.
Now, for people who are wondering about the methodology, because the graph that Google published was not a ranking, it was not a top 10 chart, it was actually a XY graph, based on how cool teens thought it was and how aware of it they were. So we're comparing brands that are about the same level of awareness, right?
Got it. So they're about the same on the Y plane, but this is the one farther on the X.
Yes.
Got
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
So that's 110. Let's go to the next one. We'll start with Justin. Justin, which brand do teens find cooler, Vice or Lyft?
I really wanted this next one to be, all right, which original American colony did
Roanoke or Williamsburg?
Oh my God, Vice and Lyft. Are you kidding me? This is 40-year-old hell. This is great.
Vice and Lyft.
Drones.
That's right.
I'm going to say Lyft.
You're going to say Lyft? All right.
It's pink, and it don't stink.
All right. Now, this is a case where they are roughly equal in brand awareness, but we're trying to figure out which one they think is cooler.
Correct.
All right.
So I'm going to say I think teens can't really afford to use Lyft, and so they probably get their rides paid for by their parents, who probably think that Uber is cooler, whereas Vice they can watch for free online. So I'm going to say Vice.
Okay.
I think Will's reasoning is misguided, idiotic, and borderline racist. And I'm going to say, but he, even a broken clock is right twice a day. So I'm going to say Vice.
You're going to say Vice? No, I think Will's logic is absolutely perfect, but that's the reason why it would be Lyft, because the parents are like, I'm going to get you on Uber. And they're like, oh my God, Uber sucks.
Oh my God, you love misogyny, huh, mom and dad?
Yeah, anyway, why don't you not buy your female employees sweaters or some shit? I don't know. I don't read Recode. I'm 8.
I'm sticking with Vice.
I feel like misogyny was my high school teacher.
Mrs. Ogeny, please.
Ms. Ogeny.
Ms.
By a long shot, teens thought Lyft was much cooler.
Whoa,
than Vice.
The Vice?
That's right.
Sorry, old man. Gorilla handheld documentaries are so in the past. We're all into banging our favorite YouTube celebrity.
You know what's funny is, like, if anything, I'm going to put it in as I should have realized that Vice makes the mistake of appearing to try. And there's like, trying too hard, hashtag cringy.
Someone hasn't watched their TV channel in a while then. All right, let's do another round of which brands.
Wait, are you saying that they're clearly not trying very hard?
They have a very cool minimalistic style.
Okay.
All right, here's the next round of which brands touch teens.
I love the fact that they're clearly
not
teens.
That interstitial is just amazing.
We're going to start with Will.
I just want to throw my hands up and wander around in a plaid shirt
up.
Will,
with people of ambiguous sexuality.
Which brand did teens find, rather millennials find cooler, McDonald's or Starbucks?
Oh, that's really hard because they're both lame. Okay.
But he did say he was just coupling them. So like,
yeah.
Like they're aware,
so which is
of
like
the,
marginally
this is high
less
awareness.
Late.
Right, they're both high awareness.
Now keep in mind, oh actually I'm not gonna give you my brilliant insights.
Yeah, I'm gonna say that they thought Starbucks was cooler because McDonald's makes you fatter than coffee.
Okay, right.
All right, number one, like McDonald's is so uncool that I'm going to bet that there's some section of the teenage populace that in a punk rock way wants to say it's cool.
Like, oh, it's 180'd.
It's like McDonald's is the new smoking, right? Like, like it's clearly deadly, a bad idea, and you should not do it, which kind of makes it punk rock, which means, you know,
yeah.
Fuck you, the man. I'm gonna shove fat in my face. Also,
in some sense, it makes it the old smoking.
Every single here's the deciding factor. Every single teenager's mom loves Starbucks. Therefore, they do not love Starbucks.
Okay.
And so I'm going to say McDonald's.
Can I ask for a clarification?
Sure.
Yes.
Was this survey taken before or after the 1998 Mulan McDonald's Szechuan sauce?
It was taken before the Szechuan, at least the resurgence of the meme.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? You're right. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Good.
That's a good point. No, I'm going with McDonald's, because I have a 13-year-old, and she would definitely rather go to McDonald's than Starbucks.
Okay. Now, remember, these are millennials. This is 18 to 24.
That's fine.
Okay, Justin.
I am going to say 150%. This is Starbucks. McDonald's is mega lame. It's for babies. It's unhealthy. It's super gross. Starbucks, 150%.
All right. Will and Justin, you get the point on that. Starbucks was very, very popular.
Like by how much?
In your face, Schwartz, teenage.
Actually, here, Bryce. Whenever there's an ending of a round, that's where you should play the Touch Teens.
Oh, okay.
sounder, and that'll cue us up to the next one.
All right, Justin, Will, you Touch Teens. All right, we're gonna start with Brian on this one.
Yeah.
Snapchat or Instagram?
Oh, Snapchat for the win. I know that much.
Okay.
Snapchat, because your parents ain't on it. That's their slogan. That's sure. That they had that. I remember the CEO had it laser etched on his forehead, and he was all bloody for his IPO.
Sure.
Yeah, this is Snapchat. Although Insta hot, Insta's still hot, but I'm gonna say Snapchat.
Hot but not lit, much like a fire that's being boiled.
Will.
Much like
a
seat
like a
right
fire
now.
Fire that's being boiled. A campfire. All right.
I think you're making the fundamental teens are millennials mistake. I think teens think Snapchat is hotter because the teens get that Snapchat stuff. Millennials don't understand how the fuck Snapchat works and can barely get it to work on their phone or swipe in the right direction, let alone put stupid rainbow poop filters on their face. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to say millennials think Instagram is cooler.
Whoa.
Right. Brian and Justin, you touched teens.
Whoa! I'm in love with these visuals. I don't know what the new program is, but if you're able to just do this all the time, this is great on the video.
I have such great reasoning for every answer, yet it's entirely wrong every time.
I mean, luckily you don't work for a magazine that dictates style and stuff.
That's right, Brian, I don't.
Too soon. Hashtag too soon.
Too soon.
All right, Justin, real quick. Beats by Dre or Vans?
Oh, shit.
Beats by Dre, for sure. I think Vans was very much my, Vans were the Converse of my generation. So, like, the generation before me had Converse, we had Vans. I think that Beats by Dre is that's the cool thing.
Okay. Will.
See, I want to say that I think people now think Beats is, like, a little bit corporate sellout since it went to Apple. On the other hand...
Apple's still cool. Like, it didn't get sold to fucking Walmart.
Is Apple cool, though, or is Apple a bit passé now? I feel like taking Brian's, like, logic, then, like, the punk rock would be, like, Linux or something.
Worth mentioning that even the metaphor of punk rock is, like, 50 years old.
Okay, Vans or Beats by Dre? Oh my God. Okay. I'm going to agree on the basis that everything that I thought I knew was wrong and up is down. I'm going to go Beats by Dre.
Okay. Brian.
I feel like now here's the next layer that we haven't discussed. I feel like you, Bryce Castillo, specifically are choosing these to fuck with our heads. You want us like, you know, like Brian wants to believe that Vans can get a third bounce from the late 70s, early 80s to the Warped Tour late 90s. And now they're back again.
Okay.
But I think it's got to be Beats. I mean, kids are still.
I love that Brian has Bryce as like a Moriarty of useless shit. Like, steps ahead.
I mean, first of all, for the record, take a look at Bryce and tell me he wouldn't make a great Moriarty of useless shit. Like he would have that perfect the cackling.
The Moriarty of useless shit, Bryce Castillo.
Hey there.
Hey, that's
kids.
Still a better intro than I got, bitches.
God damn it.
All right. Well, Brian, Justin,
who won?
And Will. None of you touched team.
Wait. Vans?
Back?
Shoes.
Vans are cooler than Beats?
Yeah, because everyone knows Beats are overpriced.
But.
Damn, son.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, my whole worldview's been destroyed. Well,
man, you had it. You gave the whole explanation of how they were having the third bounce.
Yeah. No, it turns out. I mean, that's one of those things where it's like I lost the battle, but I guess I'm happy that I've won the war.
I also think
like Vans are back. That's all I need in my life.
Well, also I think shoes are inherently more interesting than headphones.
What? Oh, they're more universally accessible.
That's an existential leap to make, Bryce.
Well, hey, look.
Shoes are more inherently interesting than headphones.
Well, I mean, they're certainly more inherently important.
Is there some chart that Google's put together to work that out?
I mean, you wear headphones.
Listen, Will, we don't call them the Moriarty of interesting points, right?
By the way, did you play the stinger?
We did.
Yeah. Okay, good.
But we're starting a new round of Which Brands Touch Teens? Now, these are going to be Gen Z. These are 13 to 17-year-olds, though.
Younger than millennials.
Google did admit Gen Z will obviously include people who are younger than 13 right now.
Mm.
And we're going to start with Will. Which is more cooler to Gen Z, Doritos or Oreo?
Good Lord.
Are they called Hydrox?
I love the fact that it's dripping with actual hate. It's like, Bryce, you are a monster. You're a beast. What are you doing to us?
As the English person here, I feel like I should be able to Sherlock Holmes this Moriarty shit, but it's just completely escaping me.
The words appear around me. Yeah.
I literally have no idea. I'm going to hit randomizer.com.
Which do you think is cooler?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm not a 13-year-old girl.
I know, but you got to think there and then maybe work backwards.
I mean, work backwards from 13-year-old girl to 34-year-old guy.
That math is well understood.
That could work. Okay, talk it out. Doritos. Do you know which is cooler? Doritos, because they have the cool chip flavor.
Cool ranch.
They're literally cooler.
Okay. That is the daddest thing you've ever spoken on our show. So I'm going to say Oreo.
Okay, Justin.
I'm going to say Doritos seems like there could always be the cool ranch of their generation. Like there can be invented the thing.
The ranch of a generation.
The ranch of a generation.
Could you imagine, like, in the Pepsi? Dorito food lab, they're just, like, trying. It's like, this one is called Scallion Extreme. It's like, oh, God damn it, Johnson. This is the cool ranch of a new generation.
And since like they're all by PepsiCo.
The new WWE star.
All right. Despite the fact that this is a racially conscious generation and the name is a slur, I'm going to go with Oreo.
All right, Brian and Justin, you guys touch teens.
Yeah!
That's right. 3-5-1. All right, we got a couple more here. We'll start with Brian.
The loss was worth 10,000 points, right?
We do have a special round that'll be worth a lot of points. We're starting with Brian.
Yeah.
Which is cooler to Gen Z, teenagers, Facebook or Facebook Messenger?
Oh, you filthy motherfucker. You dirty, slug-doggin' millionaire. God damn it.
Slug-dog?
Slug-doggin' millionaire.
Slug-dog millionaire.
It's a real thing. Look it up. I'm going to go with Messenger.
You're going to go with Messenger? All right, Justin?
I am going to say that the chat is hot with the kids. Anything that you can talk to your friends on Wi-Fi so your parents don't know is hotter than some shit that your parents are on. So I'm going to say Facebook Messenger is hotter.
Okay. Will.
See, it's tough because neither are cool. The kids all want that. They all want that WhatsApp.
Look, nobody's disputing that the kids are wrong. I mean, we're all on the same page here. We're old white men, and we all agree that the kids are wrong. But what direction are the kids wrong? The kids are all wrong.
In which particular way are they fucked up? So I guess Messenger has got them bots. Do people care about
them
those
bots?
Chat bots?
Sure, chat
bots. I like the way you adopt the patois of the Generation Z. Dem bots.
Dem bots be lit. What?
Bitmoji icon of shrug face, Will?
Shrug face, I guess I'm lit. Yeah, it's Messenger.
All three of you have said Messenger, and all three of you did not touch teen.
Oh, no!
Facebook was extremely popular.
Wow!
Much more so.
Wow!
Well, it's done the Brian. It's become so uncool, it's gone back to being cool again.
I guess so. It's like, hey, what's punk rock? Having all of your data stored and sold behind your back.
Facebook and Facebook Messenger are kind of on different planes of use, right? Like, you're not comparing Facebook and Facebook Messenger if you're a teen. You're comparing Facebook Messenger and Snapchat and Instagram.
Or you know, some other chat thing, right? Okay. Like the chat app and
Kick.
iOS or something like that.
That's right. All right, here's a good one. We're going to start with, I believe we're going to start with Will.
I think it's Justin.
Yeah. Justin, which is cooler to Gen Z, TMZ or Costco?
Holy shit. So we're at the bottom of the barrel here. Fuck.
It's like, who's cooler, Stalin or Hitler? Like,
Stalin, obviously. That's not even a thing. Yeah.
Somebody asked Sean Spicer.
Who's cooler, Donald Trump or a potato?
Well, that's...
Hey, Jim, SJW, Libtard, fuck.
Snowflake.
Snowflake, fuck. I think TMZ still brings the goods. TMZ will still tell you if your favorite DJ passed out from a heroin overdose. So, like there still is a utility to TMZ, where Costco, like, as somebody entering his mid-30s, I feel like I am only now understanding the rich value that Costco provides to my life. So, like, I'm gonna say TMZ.
All right, Will, TMZ or Costco?
Yeah, I don't think kids have any like idea of really what Costco is or does. It's just somewhere they probably get dragged around by their parents. So I'm going to say TMZ because it brings the boobies.
I am going to say that the most magical moments of my life, even when I wasn't spending my own money, the very concept of going to Sam's Club was magic. I would see gigantic shrink-wrapped rolls of toilet paper, and I'm like, I don't know how much toilet paper is worth, but that seems like a really good value. I see a big number and a smaller number next to it. That's the number we're going to pay. I'm going to say Costco.
All right, Justin and Will, you did not touch teens.
Yeah!
Overwhelmingly, teens loved Costco. TMZ is one of the lowest rated brands represented.
People hate TMZ.
They hate it. All right, we got one more in this round.
I guess everybody does hate it, right? Like, yeah. I guess I love it because it's like,
salacious.
It brings the heat.
Yeah.
And by the way, I mean like every once in a while they'll publish something before other people do, but other times it's just literally running into James Harden outside of a nightclub and asking him if he likes Swedish fish.
Right. By the way, we had a preview. We had like a foreshadowing event with Vice scoring very poorly too.
Yeah, we should have picked that up.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we got one more in this round. We're going to start with Will. Will, which did Gen Z think was cooler, Red Bull or Coca-Cola?
Was Coca-Cola the voice of a generation, or was that something else?
No, Pepsi was the voice, the choice of a new generation.
That's Pepsi, who, by the way,
improbably has totally escaped any PR fallout because of United. John Spicer. They're just like, oh shit, we can just do another one, right? Hey, Kylie, do you want to, like, you know, douse a flaming cross and 2 liters and Pepsi?
We got a brand new episode. This one, a monk is in the middle of burning himself alive to protest the war, but you put out a 2 liter of Pepsi on him, and he saves his life, and he thanks you for saving his life.
Then he does a backflip, reveals that he's actually Steve McCoy.
The place, Tiananmen Square.
Coca-Cola or
Red Bull, the energy drink.
I don't think Gen Zers are old enough to be drinking Red Bull, but then maybe that's what makes it cool. Do kids drink Red Bull?
Are you asking that seriously or rhetorically?
No, I was asking that seriously. I was like,
I'm not going to answer. Look, hey, everybody on the top half of the screen is not interested in helping you get this point. How about that?
Hey, the people on the right side of the screen,
too. Not even like a cock sympathy point.
This is 13 to 17 year olds.
Coca-Cola.
Okay.
It's got to be Coke. Kids have barely heard about Red Bull, 13 to 17.
Yeah, apparently, but what we've learned is that kids 13 to 17 have the exact same taste as Gen X if they like Vans and they drink Coke. So there we go.
All right, well, that is right. All of you guys touch teens.
Yay! We touch teens.
We touch teens. All right, we've got the final round here. We're going to go rapid fire. Ooh. I've pulled the top 10. They did pull out the top 10 brands for Gen Z. We're going to go in order, and you're just going to tell me if you're just going to give me a brand. And if it's on the top 10 list, I'm going to give you points.
Oh, shit.
Inverse proportional. So the number one will give you 10 points. The number 10 will give you 1 point.
Okay.
Is this like family feudals?
It's like family feudals.
Okay, how many points?
Can I go first?
I think it's your turn. Sure.
Me?
Actually, it's my turn first. Oh, okay, that's fine. Go. I'm going to start with YouTube.
Brian, you touched some teens.
Yeah! How many teens did I touch?
10.
Oh, I touched 10 teens!
You got number one. All right, Justin.
We already did Snapchat, right? So that's off the board?
No.
Everything is in play.
Everything's in play, except for YouTube, which was the number one one.
Snapchat.
No, Justin, you didn't touch any teens.
Oh!
What?
Didn't touch any teens, bro.
Will.
I am going to say Apple.
Will, you didn't touch any teens, bro.
What?
Any teens.
You ready?
All right, Teen Master.
Google.
Brian, you touched teens.
Oh, how many teens did I touch?
You touched 8 teens. Ah, that was number 3.
So many teens.
This is a blowout.
This is a great game. I love this game.
Brian is going to go down.
IBM.
No, you did not touching teens on that one, Jess.
Will?
All right. Apparently, yeah, because apparently all teens are now just 45-year-old men. The Gin Blossoms, the Violet Femmes.
YouTube and Google are very conservative answers.
You only get one chance. What are you doing?
Oh, wait, no, I didn't touch him? Oh, I'm sorry.
All right, no, what for reals, on, what's, for your, real, what's, for your, real. What's your guess?
Stormin' Norman Schwarzkopf.
All right, Will.
The EIB network.
Storm and Norman, I love the teens, Snerdly. Apparently, have you heard Snerdly? I'm just saying. Yeah, I know. Apparently, these teens love Facebook more than Facebook Messenger. We'll be right back, you lip-tard cuck.
You lip-tard cuck. Okay. Oh, my God.
Will?
Okay, I'm going to say...
Remember, we're talking about brands here. It's not just everything that we talked about.
Robot just says Oxycontin. No,
Twitch.
Will, you did not touch any teens with Twitch.
You know what the teens like? They like Amazon. Amazon.com.
Swear to God if you get this.
You didn't touch any teens, Brian.
Oh, shit.
Yes.
You didn't any teens. Justin.
Facebook. Facebook. Is Facebook on there?
Facebook's not on the board.
Oh!
Not on the board.
GoFuckMe.com.
GoFuckMe.com. Will, remember, this is not out of everything we've talked about. This is
full stop.
The entirety of brands.
Yeah. REM.
The Humpty Dance.
What about...
the Million Dollar Home page.
Gucci.
Say again?
Gucci?
Gucci is not on this list.
You know what? I'm going to say... It was from the kids that they called it Netflix and Chill. Show me Netflix.
Brian, you touched teens. You touched nine kids. One, two, and three.
I touched nine kids. I got the top three.
Oh, they're teens. Sorry, they're not kids. They're teens. I mean, that's all. You did get the top three.
Teens, come on.
All right. Any last guesses? Just open season, you guys?
I'll go Nike.
Nike was number nine.
Oh, I touched two teens.
You touched two teens.
Hulu.
I think the score counter is broken at this point. I know it's up.
No, Hulu was not on here, though Hulu did rank pretty high in terms of streaming services.
Tesla.
No, Tesla was not on here either.
Domino's.
No, but not a crazy guess.
Pepsi.
No.
Coke.
Paul Abdul.
None of those. Actually, Coke consistently rated more cool than Pepsi along millennials and Gen Z.
Coke, but Coke Donald did not Trump. Hit the top 10.
No, none of those.
Barack Obama.
Chipotle,
no. Though Chipotle was outcooled by Kellogg's.
Wow.
LinkedIn,
okay.
Them Gen Z love LinkedIn.
Twitter.
No.
Nope.
Actually.
Teens hate Twitter.
Yeah. I think...
Insta?
No social networks on the top 10.
Wow.
I mean, YouTube, I guess.
Teens
but...
hate Twitter as much as I hate this game at this point.
Oh, I know. Lollapalooza.
Lollapalooza.
Four non-blondes.
$10 waters.
Night Attack.
Oh, hey, look, yeah. Night Attack's number 10. No.
Al-Qaeda. The Al-Aqsa Murder Brigade. Got Rarefat.
The Golden State Warriors.
Coming in at number 10.
The Underground Railroad.
Is Chrome.
Oh, shit. Google Chrome, the browser?
Google Chrome came in at number 10.
Wow.
Oh, we got
fuck
Nike.
He's getting laid over Google Chrome.
Internet Explorer 6.
Hey, Susie, you want to come over to my house and we can share some extensions?
Number 8 was Doritos.
Wait, Doritos itself? Not Frito-Lay, the brand that it's a subcategory of?
That's right. Doritos is number 8.
What the fuck?
Mountain Dew?
Number 7 is PlayStation.
Oh, shit. That's a good one.
Did
Xbox make the list?
Xbox didn't make the list.
Oh. Wait, ahead of PlayStation?
Yep.
Wow.
Number 6 is GoPro.
Whoa. What the fuck? Really?
Mm-hmm. Number 5 is Oreo. Remember, Oreo came out higher than Doritos.
Yeah.
Yep. Also, remember, that's a slur.
and number 4 was Xbox.
It's also a sex position.
Nintendo was a little bit lower. But no, Xbox came in at number 4. So, Brian, apparently you're the teen whisperer.
Yeah, well, apparently it helps having an actual teenager who lives in my house so that I know what she's into.
Well, we can say definitively that Brian touches teens.
Hey man, before we get into our business segment, we got a new thing from your friend of mine, Otfi, sent over a new 1 minute jam that I enjoyed quite a bit.
Yeah. The legend, the genius, Stephen Cogswell, whenever he makes something, we play it. If you want to send more music to us, please feel free to do it. Hit us up on Twitter. Hit us up on email, justinrobertyoung@gmail.com. You can go ahead and send it too. We have a Night Attack one too, right, Bri- or, Bryce?
Yeah. Yeah. Mail at nightattack.tv or at Night Attack Show on Twitter.
But the namesake for Awtfy, AWTFY, is "And With That, Fuck You." And with that, we play the newest Stephen Cogswell jam.
You can probably still shoot heroin in their bathrooms.
Probably, probably. I mean, I once got busy in a Burger King.
Oh?
Crazy. Allow me to amaze thee. They say I'm ugly, but it just don't faze me.
No. Are you still getting in the girls' pants?
Hell, even at my own pants.
The Humpty Dance is your chance to do the hump.
E-I-B. Boners.
Get that hat, throw it on the ground. Take it off, girl, take it off. It is a song, two girls who wear hats. Scotty bros, Scotty bros, make your motherfucking knees touch your elbows. Scotty bros, Scotty bros, make your motherfucking knees touch your elbows.
You can't get an infection in the booty hole.
You can't get an infection in your booty hole, booty hole, booty hole, booty hole.
In your booty hole, oh no, get in your booty hole.
It's a booty hole.
I like the unexpected appearance of Mike TV singing about booty holes with like genuine gravitas.
That song just always reminds me that like Mike TV's a legitimate rock star who like randomly hangs out with us.
Yes.
Organized like a Patreon or a Kickstarter or something for a Stephen Cogswell Mike TV collab album. Collabum.
I'm in.
It's kind
in
of
on that shit.
It's kind of amazing that he just pops in periodically and just like sings the random shit that like we come up with on this show. Thank you so much to Stephen Cogswell, of course. AWTFY Awtfy.com is where you can check out all of his work, and we encourage you to not only do that but to also buy it. And you can get that as awtfy.com/bootyhole. You can't get an infection in your booty hole. It's a booty hole.
In the meantime, we're going to do a little bit of Diamond Time. Diamond Time is the portion of the program where we get to shout out your projects. If you head on over to diamondclub.reddit.com, you'll find a sticky post right up top. Suggest your projects, and if it's voted in the top three, we'll talk about it right here, right now, including a submission from JF Dubow. Hey, Diamond Club, you guys heard about Dragon Con? Did you know about the Dragon Awards? Did you know it's nomination season for the Dragon Awards? Well, now you know. You know what would be rad? Getting Tom Merritt's awesome science fiction masterpiece, Pilot X, in the science fiction novel category. While you're there, you can also maybe drop a little love my way and nominate my upcoming horror novel, A God in the Shed, in the horror novel category. Which, by the way, I thought the whole title of the book was A God in the Shed in the horror novel category, but then I realized I was wrong. If I get nominated, I'll put myself further in debt and come lose in person at Dragon Con again. Just go to bit.ly/DragonShed2017 and fill out the form. Tom Merritt's Pilot X for science fiction novel, and if you feel generous, J.F. Dubow's A God in the Shed in a horror novel. That's from J.F. Dubow, friend of the show.
I'll tell you what, please, please, please do that, because I would love to force Tom Merritt to come out to Dragon Con again. Meanwhile, hey, by the way, we only got two here, so if somebody wants to jam something in there last minute, then yeah, you better just get jam, on your, just get jam your horse.
It. Just touch a teen and just jam it.
Oh, just fuck, jam. Why did you mix those two things?
Just
that's
jam
weird.
Just and touch that team that you and said jam it. Touch that team, jam it.
This
just
is way
jam
worse
it.
when you see what they're promoting.
Just jam it.
Also, now we have 11. Abaka Nobaka says, "Greetings, Diamond Group. My big brother is putting on his big girl panties and getting ready to kick ass in the upcoming Lifetime Chicago Triathlon on August 27, 2017. Not only that, but he's doing it for charity, as he'll be running for Team Save the Children. It's a charity geared toward helping needy children all around the world through various programs. He's pledged to raise $500 and is reaching out to anybody willing to spare a few bucks in support. Don't be the lame ass standing around the water cooler at work who didn't help a stranger's big brother reach his charity goal. Whether you want to help save dying kids or help my big bro of help fund a charity that helps save dying kids, go to tinyurl.com/bigbrosaves and toss him a few bucks in support. If you do, throw up the diamond in your donation comment and let the world know that Diamond Club was there. All the best. Baka no baka.
Yeah, man, just jam it. I think that's what he's really saying is just jam it. Just jam it. Grab a teen and jam it.
Oh, right.
W. Scott is one reminds us that DCTVpedia.com is a great Diamond Club wiki. Bye. Thank
it's
you very
much.
It's
an amazing resource.
It really is, dude. Completely community driven. It's as a matter of fact, we use it all the time for when we're doing Scam School remixes. Where oh man, it makes me so happy to see all these new shows on there. 1-900 Wrestling, The Modern Rogue, My So-Called 8-Bit Life. I guess that's not a new one, but dude, it's great. It's great. It's great. It's great.
Of course, Diamond Time is when we shout out your projects. Just head on over to reddit.com/r/diamondclub or diamondclub.reddit.com to make sure that you get your project up there. The top three upvote to get read every single week on this show.
Yeah, but in the meantime, we're going to check in with this week's Movie Drop Minute.
Welcome to Movie Drop Minute presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of April 10th, 2017. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. I've always loved the travel anyway. The open road, the smell of wind in my face, the flies clogging up my grill. Let's go check the scoreboard. Team Nitech is in sixth place, still waiting for their first film. Team DTS is in fifth place with Smurfs Lost Village bringing in $14 million this week. Team Core Killers is in fourth place with $27 million. Team Scotch Bros is in third place with $48.7 million. Team Frog Pants is in second place with $75.1 million. And in first place with a whopping $89.3 million. It's Team Big and Tall. And that is your movie for the week of April 10th, 2017.
Dude, enjoy your moment in the sun, Big and Tall, because DTNS is coming to bite your ass. It's going to munch right through, right up your gullet.
Ass.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Give me that ass. It's I want to bite it. I'm DTNS. Ah, nah, nah, nah.
you heard about the steak bet I had with Tom, right? About Boss Baby versus Ghost in the Shell?
I believe so, yeah.
Well, specifically, like, I was talking about which would outperform. I said Boss Baby would do better Ghost in the Shell. And he was like, no. Ghost in the Shell is going to blow up. It's going to be great. It's going to be huge. I was like, no. Boss Baby will not only defeat Ghost in the Shell, it will make twice as much money. He's like, no, yeah. I'll bet you a stake on that. And it turns out I was wrong because it did not make twice as much money. It made three times the money and still dominates this weekend. It was the number one movie again, second in a row.
That Ghost in the Shell really took a little poop, huh?
Yeah. No. Meanwhile, Fate of the Furious is going to be make or break for DTNS. Like, basically, actually, I take that back. They're pretty well diversified. Do you think Fate of the Furious is going to be the biggest or a flop?
Oh no! that is some real embrace debate level options. Like, will it be the biggest movie ever, or will it not make a penny? Your decision. Go.
Welcome to Night Attack. I'm glad you picked up.
I think it's going
to
do projections, which is very very well. I think it's like it's kind of brilliant because it's fresh. You know, if you've seen all the other movies, now you want to see why Vin Diesel's the bad guy. In this one, I read a review and like the review on like the hipster movie site that I read was like, it deserves to make all the money. I'm not going to tell you that it's a good movie, but it's so crowd pleasing that it's going to make a shit ton of money and you're not going to feel bad about it. It's so ridiculous and nonsensical, but you're going to have a great time the whole time and it's going to be awesome.
Ridiculous, nonsensical, and crowd pleasing. I think we found the new title for this show.
there we go.
At least a new aspiration. That's where we should be targeting from now on.
Exactly. Ridiculous, nonsensical, and 12 people pleasing.
And also an infection-free booty hole. yeah, dude. The only thing I'm looking at that makes me happy is that DTNS definitely whiffed on Smurfs The Lost Village. It was a total bomb. So, but on the other hand, they only paid $7 for the movie, so... It wasn't like they were leaning heavily on it.
Yeah, I mean, so what do they have coming up? Like, what do they need to shit the bed on for us to do well?
They need to shit the bed on like four different movies. That's the problem. We need our three movies to all do well to have a chance.
Yeah, unfortunately, guys, I think they need to basically have the worst losing streak in the history of mankind for you guys.
Yeah, okay. These are the movies that need to tank. Smurfs: The Lost Village, which did tank, so that's one down. Fate of the Furious has to underperform. Captain Underpants has to underperform. Wonder Woman has to underperform, and Atomic Blonde can do as good as it wants to do.
So, effectively, we need Fate of the Furious that people are like, all right, enough with the cars. Like, America and all ships at sea to say, yeah, enough with the cars, okay?
Either that or that they need to just hate submarines. They're like, hey, man, I don't watch Fate of the Furious for submarines, bro. That's not cool.
Captain Underpants is going to do whatever. It's a new kids franchise, so it might not do all the money in the world. Wonder Woman, we just need the word to get out that movie sucks early. So it kind of like sours people on
it. Let's start the rumor now that it's, first of all, I think that it was inappropriate for them to reveal in the first act that Wonder Woman was actually a man. I thought this would be a vehicle that would promote strong women archetypes. Sure. But by making her a man, I think they crossed a line.
Also, we need to blow up our own movies. So is it out of line to say that we know personally that Guardians of the Galaxy 2 has the big Thor scene in the credits?
Well, that's
right?
That's the big secret is that
we can't say where we know.
Wait, is that true, though?
I mean, if only one of our friends, you know, wrote a giant Marvel movie, we can say
We can't say where this comes from.
Right. But let's say we had an insider who personally confirmed that the entire last half of Guardians of the Galaxy is actually the first chapter of the Infinity Wars. Like,
Of Ragnarok and...
And Infinity Wars.
Because remember, Ragnarok just dropped the most watched trailer in the first 48 hours of any Marvel movie ever. It's the hottest thing on the planet. So Thor Ragnarok, you can't watch Thor Ragnarok unless you watch Guardians of the Galaxy 2.
Right. As a matter of fact, if I remember correctly, the entire first act of Thor Ragnarok is Thor and Captain America arguing about whether or not it's possible to enjoy the movie if they haven't watched Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2.
Yeah. So, we can't tell you where. Maybe next week there might be another big trailer dropping.
Can we talk just a real quick bit about how great that Thor Ragnarok trailer is? Like, it was the best. Happiest. It made me the happiest in 2017. I think I've been like I burst out laughing just with random joy at that moment. Not only the surprise reveal that it's Planet Hulk and all that stuff, but specifically that of all the ways to express his relief, to phrase it as he's a friend from work was so.
I know
perfect.
Him. He's a friend from work, and just a disappointment. Just the idea that trailer, it's not even a trailer, it's like a teaser, right? Like, it just builds kind of so perfectly to the point where, like, the absurdity is like Jeff Goldblum in full Jeff Goldblum, just like, I'm a gladiator, runner, man. I run the Colosseum. Who have you brought for me? Like,
also, I'm dressed as if I belong on the Council of Ricks for no apparent reason. I'm
for
Jeff
no
Goldblum.
Apparent reason. And then he disappoints the crowd by how excited he is. That's my favorite part.
I love when they have Immigrant Song building up to the sort of the Valhalla reference. Which
dude,
is
the
really,
Immigrant
really
Song, you know, it's a cheap pop to take a well-known song, but... Of all the well-known songs
that
to riff on, pretty great pick for Thor, right?
Well, and also it's like this is the difference between Marvel and DC, right? Marvel just plays the song, and DC has the creepy children sing it, right? Like it's just.
Well, and by the way, I love the fact that they're just embracing this idea of making it as Guardians of the Galaxy, right? Where it's just like, hey, so guess what's in 1980s schlock. We're going to make the fonts crappy. We're going to go over the top on the action and the silliness, and it's going to be a lot of fun. You're going to have a great time.
Yeah,
it's kind of interesting how like the sort of like the cosmic Marvel universe is now kind of like more interesting than the sort of like slightly more gritty kind of like Earth-based stuff.
Well, and,
like,
and
I'm
by the way,
more excited for this than I am for anything else.
The only way that Justin and I win the movie draft is if Guardians of the Galaxy way overperforms, and the only way I can believe that's possible is if there's a secret reason that is being held and not leaked yet to the media that Guardians of the Galaxy, you know, really does. I mean, we were joking about it before, but it really does have to kind of be the first subchapter of the Infinity Wars. We have to see massive crossover with the other characters from the Marvel Universe. If that happens and it rolls straight into Thor Ragnarok, I mean, what a fun, ridiculous trip it's going to
be.
Well,
I mean, also the other thing that we're kind of betting on is that it overperforms so much in its first couple weeks that Disney and Marvel say, all right, well, let's pay to keep it in theaters, and theater owners want to keep it in theaters, and they want to keep the marketing machine on hype. So like we're betting on a lot. I don't love our slate. Again, we're gonna mention this every single week until the end of the movie draft, but it's like we're asking for all three of our movies to vastly overperform, which is never a position where you're gonna be. But if you're gonna do it, you kind of like the movies that we have, you know, that they are likely to overperform, which is not by gigantic amount.
Hoping so, but again, I mean, and this is like the most douchebaggy thing to say is like, but both of us have won enough drafts that we're not going to be upset with the second or third place.
Hey, you're the one who has 2 years of dominance on the line.
Yeah, that's fine. I whatever. It's a great game. I love playing it. It's awesome.
It's a heavy crown, Justin. You can't wear it all the time.
Well, I'll tell you what. We are wrapping up. But I was gonna do all the bona fides for Will to let everybody know where people can find him. But there's somebody that I just realized this week that can do that for me, ladies and gentlemen. For the first time properly in several years to sing Will's praises, allow me to introduce you back
to Fat Rick Santorum.
Oh, Rick Santorum. You sort of dropped off the radar there. I see you're still eating.
Yeah, I know, Ryan. I'm just saying, hello, the episode. I thought it was great.
Oh, that's wonderful. What are you up to these days?
Oh, I was just following Will Harris' Twitter account, at Will Harris. There's only one L in Will, unlike the L's that I eat when I run for president.
Okay. Wait, oh, you mean you're talking about L's as in losses.
I take L's. I eat them. I call
So originally you were talking about how you were carb loading for the energy so that you could run for president appropriately. Is that are you still eating?
Well, I yes.
Well,
I thought I was going to win, Brian, and then I didn't. I had a pancake dinner, and then I had a pancake lunch, and then I had a pancake breakfast.
So
and then he spent the whole afternoon running to the bathroom.
I am. I'm going to be pooping my face off. I'm
Fat Rick Santorum, are you pleased with how the Republican Party shook out and with our current president? I mean, I would imagine as a Republican Party member, you're pretty happy that your team's in charge and of both the Congress and the presidency.
I got a lot of thoughts. First and foremost, as it results to Syria, I can't believe the Taco Bell's putting a taco and a burrito together. It's the most exciting thing I've ever seen in my entire life. I mean, sure, Assad gassed those children, and there deserves to be reprisals. But, oh, my God, I know I can eat two of them, and I'll be eating four tacos and four burritos. I love it.
A quick question from the audience. They're asking, you've become Fat Rick Santorum. Have you thought about, as Fat Rick, have you thought about finding a Fat Morty to join you? Or maybe a Slim Morty?
I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about, but I do know this. I love gumdrops.
What is it you love about gumdrops?
I love putting them in my mouth, and I love eating them. I love them so much. I'm Fat Rick Santorum. Follow @WillHarris on Twitter.
All right, so long, Fat Rick. It's good to see you, buddy.
I'm leaving. I'm going to run for president again and eat a hoagie.
You know Fat Rick?
Yeah.
Hold on, I'm back. Will, I'm so glad I could hear you.
If you need a hand, I've got a great personal trainer who can help you. You'll be laid out. You'll be dead. You can check out my Instagram.
I'll tell you what, Will, I love that because I love laying down. Anyway, guys, I'm Fat Rick Santorum. I'm leaving.
Man, a rare appearance from the former presidential candidate.
I'll tell you what, we might be seeing a lot more of Fat Rick Santorum until I grow this beard back.
I just realized, like, I think, like, a giant, like, if, okay, straight up or down vote, do we have a majority of people, if they could snap their fingers and replace Donald Trump with Rick Santorum, would they do it?
Like Fat Rick or Real Rick?
Real Rick.
I mean, no, because that's basically the Mike Pence question, right?
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like Mike Pence and Rick Santorum are kind of, in the eyes of most people, the same person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
And they're more competent than Donald Trump, which would not be good. Anyway, follow instagram.com/WillHarris because I've kind of given up on Twitter for a bit.
Why?
It's too miserable, man. There are too many people who are like, let's talk about blah, 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 /thread. / I think we need to have a discussion about
whereas
this.
Instagram, and it's just like, straight
I
up like
take the condescension anymore.
Here's a picture of me laying down. Like, who's gonna argue with that? You're gonna respond with a picture of you laying down? Come at me, bro. Go ahead. I lay down with the best of them.
I mean, right?
Will, can we confirm right here on this show that you will also be our guest at the live night attack at Nerdtacular in Snowbird, Utah?
That's not an answer. Wiggling your fingers.
It's just, apparently, unless in British street slang, your fingers.
Yeah, doing your impression of the Shadow King is not an answer. That's
yeah, I've got my ticket.
Awesome.
I'm very excited.
Awesome. Well, then you will be on stage. Everybody will be able to see Will Harris, the comedy stylings of Will Harris, when we do our live show at Nerdtacular. Anything else you want to get out there? You're going to be hanging with us for the after show, but anything else that you want to chat about real quick or get out there for people?
No, just really, really happy to be back on the show. I am looking forward to a little bit of after show. I have been the saddest thing about being on this show is always that I don't get to listen to it the next day, which sucks because I can't stand to listen to myself. So,
dude, well, regardless, man, thank you so much for joining us. Dude, good show. Justin, this is a good time. I hope the Scoops enjoyed our shenanigans.
I just wish they managed to touch
my I hope the 12 plus enjoy.
God damn it. Yeah, you're never going to let that go, are you?
Not today.
I think we learned that that Bonnie has some hang-ups about people promising sex tapes. What else do we learn?
We learned that millennials love IBM.
and the NFL. Wait, was the NFL on the list?
I don't think it was.
Wow.
No, I don't think it had sports brands.
Huh. We learned that the NFL was not on the list.
We learned that we all touch teens, but Brian touches them the most.
Yeah, no, a lot. 36 times. Hey, man, we love you guys. We'll see you next Tuesday.
Dine apart. Warm glass of Drano. Night attack, 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 night attack. I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.